darkness of night, closed off the light. Heart sank with fear. I knew my destruction was a matter of time. Jesus stepped in and said, this old boy's mine. I'm saved from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. He came looking for me. He came looking for me. He made a way when there was no way that I could see. When I drifted far, Jesus was near. Rescued my soul and calmed my fears. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. Satan had already picked out my grave. His plan had moved forward to put me away. I drifted so far, would anyone care that I should be lost? I knew my destruction was a matter of time. Jesus stepped in and said, this one is mine. I'm safe from all harm, so he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. He came looking for me. He came looking for me. He made a way when there was no way that I could see. When I drifted far, Jesus was near. He rescued my soul and calmed my fears. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me. I'm safe from all harm, for he walked through the storm. Came looking for me.
Precious years of memories. Oh, what joy.
country boy, how my heart beat with joy when I knelt in the old country church and the Savior above by His wonderful love saved my soul in the old country church. Precious years.
Sin had left its mark. Walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. Well, he can raise the dead from the grave, change the water and turn it into wine. He can.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone back to Hickox Baptist Church this morning. Michael White, if you will, how about open us in prayer this morning?
Lord, we do thank you, Lord, for another opportunity that we could come in your house and, Lord, just open your word and be reminded of how great you are, Lord, and the salvation that you provide through your blood sacrifice. And you are willing to pay so much, Lord, for humanity and for each and every one of us so we can have life and have it more abundantly through believing and trusting in you and the salvation. And repenting and accepting that salvation. We thank you for that, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity, the freedoms we still have in this country, Lord, just to serve you and honor you. We thank you, Lord, for the message and all the activity that went on last night. We just pray, Lord, that you'll bless your word and just touch hearts and continue to move in people's lives, and we praise you for that. We know there's many needs in the midst of this congregation. We just ask that you'll minister to each and every one, and we just praise you this morning. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. It is good to see everyone this morning. As Michael mentioned, there was quite a few people here last night. Brother Jimmy Sight was speaking last night at the pre-hunt. And I don't know exactly how many people there were here, but it was probably close to 700, I would imagine. There was quite a few people in the Lord's house last night. Some of them come for different reasons, but they all get to hear the Lord's word for whatever reason they come for. So they don't leave here without hearing the Lord's word. We do thank you for all the ones that helped with that in whatever capacity. But we pray that the Lord would use that different ways to bring people to him. I know that there was, looking through some of the cards this morning, there was many that said they made decisions. And we just pray that they was real and that the Lord will continue to deal with them. We will have a guest speaker this morning. I'll let Brother Jamie introduce him later. Also, there's a note in the bulletin. It's got 1 John 4:12. No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. It says, dear church, your outpouring of love for me is evidence that God is real and his word is true. Thank you for all the love and gifts, cards, calls, and especially your prayers and hugs. To the saints of Hickox Baptist Church, no words can relay what you all mean to me. God bless everyone. Miss Carolyn Strickland. September the 5th, the church office will be closed for Labor Day. And on September the 8th, there will be a bridal shower for Madison White and Josh Davis at 6:30 p.m. in the social hall. And there's a note in the bulletin that says the church league softball has begun. If you would like to go cheer our team on, this is the schedule. All the games are at the Brantley County Rec Department. And there's a schedule in the bulletin if you want to look at it. Also, for the bridal shower, there will be a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board to help with food. And there's another thank you note in there. It says, thank you all so much for all the visits, calls, food, and many prayers. They were a blessing to us all. The wreath was beautiful as well. The family of Miss Gwen Short. There was 62 in Sunday school this morning. We do have a class for any age that wants to attend Sunday school, starting from the little babies right on up. Mr. Charlie's been thinking about teaching the little babies, so. But there's a class for anyone at any age. If you want to come be a part of that, it starts at 9:45. There's some classes in the old church building, some over here. But if you'll come, I'm usually on the front porch. We'll find you a class that you need to be in or want to be in. But thank you for being here this morning.
I would say that everybody looks bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, but I'm not sure that's true. Maybe dim-eyed and a little bit of bushy, But that's okay. We had a good time last night, and again, thank you. Our speaker's going to be with us, and he's just Brother Jimmy now. I'm not going to be a great introduction to introduce him. After a while, we're going to sing a few songs, but he just seems like being one of us. I like that about him. He's just ordinary folks doing extraordinary work. Okay? And so are we. So if you want to and able to stand this morning, we're going to sing a round of songs right here, and then you're going to fellowship a minute, and we'll sit, but come back and sing one more for the offertory hymn.
Jesus is the sweetest name I know, and he's just the same as his lovely name, and that's the reason why I love him so. Oh, Jesus is the sweetest name I know. Aren't you done got through one time, Scooty? Jesus is the sweetest name I know. Thank you.
find their way back to their seats. We're going to sing one more, and this will be our offertory hymn. Thank you.
is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Feel that empty feeling. The shame's done all the stealing. Desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. And disappear. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus. All the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. You can work it all for your good. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Strong and his grace is free. The good news is I know that he do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Take my cross to Calvary, pay the price for all my guilty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong.
They told me they was going to sing that just for Mr. Jimmy for being here this morning. But that would be a story. I've been begging him for months. Months. But all the way from River Road, them's homegrown girls right there. And when they said they sing, I said what that last part, I said, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, that they going to sing for us. And we thank them so much for that. I tried to get the boyfriends back there to come stand with them. And one of them told the truth. He said, I could stand there, but I wouldn't help any. I make matters worse. I said, well, brother, you need to stay back there where you at then if that's the case. Now, again, it's good to have Brother Jimmy Sykes with us this morning, with us last night. Excited about hearing him. You know, a lot of us was real busy last night. We got bits and pieces here and there, some of us, most of you was able to stay inside and hear everything through and through, but we get an extra blessing. This is a more personal note this morning. He's able to come and be with us. We're going to ask you to come. If y'all would, greet him with a hand clap.
Thanks, brother. And that was beautiful. Are the ladies still in here that sang, or did they? Okay. I got you. They probably are back there serving or doing something already. But that was awesome. I love that song. Good morning. Everybody good to go this morning? All right. There's a lot of activity that took place last night, and I stepped out during the greeting, and boy, I'm telling you, there's a lot of activity going on with the kids over here, and we had meetings earlier on with a breakfast, and we're evaluating last night's gathering, and just already a lot happening this morning. So I want to commend this church for the great event that you had last night. I've seen a lot of these, been a part of a lot of these around the country and even out of the country, some smaller, some bigger. You have really done a great job. When you can pack this room like y'all have done last night, and you get a lot of non-Christians here, that's a great success, all right? The follow-up is very important. I encourage you to really do some follow-up with these non-Christians that were here last night and try to see if there are ways that you can involve them, because it's all relational. That's what it's about. It's relational evangelism. Share the gospel, get them interested, and then build those relationships. And continue to do what you're doing. It was a really wonderful event. And Terry is a goldmine of a person up here on the stage giving away all those prizes. He is entertainment in and of himself. And y'all got a wonderful person there, and as well as Pastor Jamie. And by the way, if you're visiting, if you came back today because you were invited, do not judge this church based on my preaching. Come back and hear Pastor Jamie, because he's the one that's regularly in this pulpit. And please don't evaluate this church based on me, okay? Come back and hear him. Give him a fair shot. Also, I want to say hi to Larry Tomberlin in the back. Wave at everybody, Larry. Larry is a longtime friend. He and his brothers from over at River Cross, near closer to Augusta. I think it is, right? I'm kind of lost. But, yeah, we have spent some time together. He's been on one or two of our shows and our TV shows. And he and I share a great love for ancient American artifacts. And boy, does he have some cool stuff that he has collected over the years. And I'll tell you something about a man with a loving heart. I get a phone call from Larry one time, and he says, "Hey, y'all going to be home tomorrow?" And I said, "Yeah." Now, he's calling from South Carolina, and we live in Nashville, Tennessee. He goes, "I got something for you." And I said, "Really?" He goes, "I'm driving it up." I said, "Really?" And I said, "Well, plan on spending the night with us." And he goes, no, I'm not going to do that." I said, "Well, of course you are. It's a long drive." Larry shows up the next day, gives us some amazing, cool artifacts, and I had fallen in love with some cypress knees from his swamp that were about, y'all ever seen cypress knees that tall? Well, I hadn't, and next thing I know, he's got some. He's bringing those to me, and they're in our house, and he turns around about an hour later and leaves. I was like, "Larry, you can spend the night. Have supper at least." "No, I need to get home." I guess you drove about 20 hours that day, didn't you, Larry? But man, we have that on display there. I take it around to farmers markets and libraries and schools and show that stuff off. And we're very proud of the preservation of those artifacts and being able to allow children especially to hold them, the knife and all that kind of stuff. So that's just the kind of guy he is. And here he's driven all the way here last night and again this morning to be with us. So make sure you meet Larry Tomberlin. And for those of you who know the Tomberlin Company, it's his brother that developed the eMERGE. That's an electric cart that I think half the people in Florida use in the retirement communities. That's the Tomberlin eMERGE. It's really a nice cart. Okay, I want us to get into a text this morning that is my favorite, one of my favorites ever since I was a little bitty boy. My father, Colonel Carol Seitz, he was married 62 years, he was a preacher 52 years, and he was in the Air Force 42 years. So he raised me. He became a Christian the year before I was born, and he raised me to be a preacher. And so by the time I was four, he'd only been a Christian 5 years, but he was already preaching. And he preached at a little country church, and he would get so nervous that he would throw up before church. And then he'd get up there and work his way through it. Became one of the greatest preachers in Arkansas history. They still play his radio show every day in North Arkansas, and he's been dead 4 years. And it's pretty amazing. He was an amazing man. But he would bring me early to church, about an hour early, and sit me on a Coke crate so I could see over the pulpit. And I would preach to my mom and my sister and my dad. And then other members began to hear about it, and they would show up. And by the time I was about six, we'd have about 40 folks there, and I preached every Sunday evening. And this was one of my two favorite sermons. And I thought, you know what? I've been doing it a long time. I'm just going to bring it out this morning. Is that okay with y'all? All right. It's the story of the Good Samaritan. You've heard of it, right? Luke chapter 10. Now, before I get into it, let's kind of set it up with something. Let's go to the city of Seattle. And it was several decades ago, and they were having a special Olympics track meet there, and it was the national championship. And the event was the 100-meter race. It was going to be one time around that track. It's kind of a sprint, and the gun was shot. Five little boys that were mentally and physically impaired began to run, and it was obvious that one of them was going to win hands down over the other one. And it was also obvious that a second little fellow was going to take second place pretty easily. Well, as it happened, the little boy in first place had made it all the way around the back curb. He only had 100 yards to go to win the national championship, the gold medal of everybody in the nation. Well, evidently, he tripped and fell. His momentum threw him on that tartan cinder track, one of those gravel tracks, and it kind of went into his elbows, and he scratched his cheek up and his knees, and he was bleeding a little bit, and he's lying there on the track crying. Well, the little fella in second place, he was just coming into the back curb, and I guess he saw this all happen out of his peripheral vision. So he just jumps off the track, goes across the infield of the football field, and gets over to where that little boy is crying, and he helps him up. And he begins to pick the gravel out of his elbow, and he takes his shirt tail, and he's getting the blood off the little fella's cheek. Well, by this time, the other three little boys made it, and they wanted to help. So they all stopped, and they're helping the little fella. And finally, they all just put their arms around each other. The little hurt boy was in the middle, and they just walked the last 100 yards together, and they all crossed the finish line together. Now, you can imagine that there was a standing ovation, right? And it lasted longer than normal. And there were a lot of people crying, you know. And there was this reporter in the stands, and he thought, what a great story. And he made his way down to interview not the little boy that was in first place, but he found the little boy that had been in second place. And in the best way he could communicate to him, he said, you won your city meet. You won your state regionals. You won the state meet. You won the national regionals. You're here at the national championship, the finals. You could have had the gold medal. All you had to do was finish the race. Then you could have gone back and helped the little boy that fell down. And that little fella preached, in my opinion, the greatest sermon ever spoken on American soil when he said these words. Not while my friend hurts. I believe maybe he had heard the story we're about to read. Maybe his parents or his pastor or a teacher had taught him this story that we call the parable of the Good Samaritan. It's found in Luke chapter 10. Get your Bibles open or open your phones up if that's how you do it. And don't try to think that we don't know if you're checking email. We have hidden cameras. Just kidding. But I actually have people that I know, they're really checking their emails when they say they're using their Bible app. Just don't clip your toenails while I'm preaching, all right? So the Good Samaritan story, Luke chapter 10, starting in verse 25, there's an expert in the law that stands up. Now, your version might say a lawyer. Don't think legal terms, I want you to think spiritual terms. In other words, this is a person that has a PhD in theology. This is a person who's gone to seminary. He has a terminal degree. He probably would teach at a Christian college or something like that. In other words, he has a PhD in Jewish scripture, what we would know as the Old Testament. He's a teacher of the law. He's an expert in the law, the 613 commandments. He stood up to test Jesus and he said, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, have you ever been asked that question by somebody? Hey, what do I need to do to be saved? Has anyone ever been asked that question? All right, so we want to be ready for that one, right? We're hoping somebody will ask us that question because we want to give them our testimony, we want to give them whatever, or our formula, recipe for salvation. And that's how most of us would respond. We would have this recipe. Well, you do this and this and this. So I think it's highly interesting that we have the Savior of the universe, the Son of God Himself, the very Lamb of God, the High Priest, who has come to save us from our sins, has been asked that question. Right? So all of a sudden, our ears all get really big. How does he answer it? Because that's how I ought to answer it. So let's just see how Jesus answers it. The guys just asked Jesus a question. What do you think Jesus is going to do? Give him a formula? Give him a recipe? No, Jesus is going to use one of his two favorite teaching styles. Do you know what it is? Asking questions. Our American education system is built on lecture. Did you realize that? Our whole concept of good education is that we have a teacher who's so good that he or she can put all this information out in such an interesting way that the student can retain and regurgitate at least 90% of it. And that's how they make their A. That's a terrible system for education. The best educators are the ones who learn how to ask questions and lead the students into thinking for themselves and coming up with the answers themselves, because then they own it. And Jesus asked, are you ready for this? 32 pages of 12-point font, single-spaced questions. 32 pages. And so he's going to use one of his favorite teaching styles. He wants the guy to answer his own question. I mean, after all, he's a teacher of the law. He should know, right? And so Jesus says to him, well, what is written in the law? How do you read it? He asked him two questions. Well, you know how the guy's going to answer. Jesus already knew how the guy's going to answer. The guy knows this better than anything. He knows it's the Shema. The Shema is that thing taught in Deuteronomy that you are to, if you know it, say it with me, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. Did you know that the people in the Old Testament, especially the teachers of the law, the Pharisees, well, the Pharisees were later on in the middle between the Old and the New Testament, but those people that were Levites and priests, they wore the Shema on their foreheads. And later on, the Pharisees, they would do that. It was a little, like, kind of like a headlamp, and it was a box, and you could slide it open, and it had a miniature scroll in it, and you roll it out, and it has the Shema on it. It was the greatest commandment. You're like, oh, no, all commands are equal. No, that's not biblical. Not all commands are equal. That's the greatest command. They believed that. That's theological. And so there it was. And they also kept it on the doorpost of their houses in a thing called a mezuzah. I'm leaving on September 6th. My wife and I are leading 29 people to Israel and Jordan. And every time we come into a house over there, there's this little box you can open up. Guess what's in the box? It's a scroll. And guess what's on the scroll? The Shema. What's the Shema? The greatest of all the commandments. What's the greatest of all the commandments? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. So the guy answers with what Jesus knew he was going to answer with. Jesus was leading him in with that question, but the guy had to think for himself, and he said it out loud. And Jesus said in verse 28, well, you've answered correctly. You do this and you'll live. Now listen to this. That was Jesus' answer to what it takes to be saved. Is that your answer? Think about it. Do this and you will live. Verse 29. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, well, who is my neighbor? So now he's asked Jesus another question. What do you expect that Jesus is going to do? You can talk here, right? Okay. Ask a question back. But Jesus doesn't. He now switches to his other favorite teaching style. Lecture, right? No. He's going to tell a story. I used to preach for about a 5,400-member church in Nashville, so the law of odds are the more members you have, the more critics you have. And I had a good number of critics. And one of them was gifted in criticism. I have never seen a person so gifted in my life. She was amazingly gifted at criticizing her preacher. She was about 5 foot tall, and every single Sunday she had something picked out that I did wrong, even down to how I wore my tie. And she would always wait on me to, you know, give me her criticism, and I was shaking hands, and here she came. Well, man, I went to shake her hand. She didn't really want to shake my hand, but she would. So that morning, she grabbed my hand, and I grabbed hers even more, and I'm hanging on to it. And she said, preacher, you tell too many stories. And then she tried to pull her hand back. I wouldn't let her take her hand back. I held on to it, and I literally got down on my knees, so my eyes looking right at hers. I said, thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Two-handed grip now. She's trying to get away. Thank you. Because I want to teach and preach as much like my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as I possibly can. And she pulled an arm away and went, and was walked off. And y'all remember Arsenio Hall back in the day? Like that. I was like, I got her. And I had to go home and repent for the sin of pride when I got home. But anyway, I don't tell stories just to tell stories. Neither did Jesus. Stories have a purpose. But I've learned from Jesus that he was a master storyteller, and he would always pick the interest of the person. Woman at the well, Samaritan woman, what'd she come to the well to get? Water. What'd she bring to the well? Water jar. What'd she leave at the well when she met Jesus? Her water jar. He started with her interest and told her he had living water, and she learned that. Whenever he called the fishermen, what did he say to them? Follow me. Leave that miraculous catch of fish you just have. Leave your new condo and boat payments. Leave the cover of the fishing magazine. And come follow me and I'll make you what? Fishers of men. He always picked up on the interest of the people. I have to do that in my job as a television producer. Because tonight at 10:30 p.m. when you turn on your television and you see 1,000 different shows coming on and you're cruising to see which one you're going to land on, you hit Spiritual Outdoor Adventures on the Pursuit Channel, I've got to have a 30-second tease during that time frame when you're channel surfing for the next show that will hook you into staying with me. It's got to be such a great tease that you don't want to keep surfing. You're at least going to say, well, maybe this is what I want to watch, and you'll do that. And then if I can hook you through the first segment, by the time we get to the end of the first segment, I'm getting close to hanging on to you for that full half hour, but I still got to keep you hooked. And so I'll have that deer coming out or whatever it is we're after that day, and the big old buck's just about to show up, and you're about to get your shot, and the bow is pulled back or the crosshairs are put on him, and then all of a sudden, just before the shot happens, goes to commercial. Oh, did he get it or not? Well, I've got you hooked. Now you're going to have to keep watching. If I can keep you through 14 minutes, there's only a 15% chance you're going to change the channel after that. So I've got to be very creative as a producer. Did you know songwriting is the same way? How many of you like to listen to songs? Any of you listen to country music? All right. Well, I write country music. And most recently, gospel. I actually got a pop cut last week. So when I write a song, I always co-write it. Nobody writes solo, hardly ever. Well, I write with my next-door neighbor. He's married to Sonia Isaacs. Do y'all like the Isaacs? All right. Well, Sonia is my next-door neighbor on the left side. Becky is my neighbor on the right side. And we live life together. And Sonia's married to Jimmy Erie. He was the lead singer for Shenandoah. Now, he's a songwriter. And he wrote, I Drive Your Truck. Remember that song? Song of the Year. He wrote Anywhere With You, Luke Bryan. He wrote Everything's Gonna Be All Right, Kenny Chesney. All number ones. Tons of them. And that boy knows how to write songs. Well, he comes to me, hey, I want to go deer hunting. So I'll take him deer hunting, and he has to write a song with me. I want to go elk hunting. I'll take him elk hunting. He got to write. So I've got six cuts that have gone out because I write with Jimmy Erie. That's how it works. All right? And you write with the right guy, you get cut. And you know what he's taught me? Here it is. You got to have a hook line. He says, Jimmy, a song is a mini movie. You can't give away the ending, just like a movie's not going to. But you've got to hook them into wanting to listen. And so the next time you turn your radio on, whether it's Southern Gospel or whatever it is, listen for the hook. What's the hook? All right? And listen to it as a mini movie and just see if that formula doesn't work for you. How about that? That's what Jesus does. As a matter of fact, you're about to see the greatest hook, the greatest tease, in my opinion, in the history of storytelling. I would imagine that in your Bible, the next verses, you've already got it highlighted with a yellow marker. You've probably already taken a red pen and underlined it. You've probably got an asterisk over on the side going, wow. I bet you've written the word wow in there because this is such an amazing beginning to a story. Are you ready for it? Here goes. It's already marked in your Bible. Verse 30, Jesus took up the question and he changed to his other favorite teaching style. He's going to tell a story. Here it is. Are you ready? Here it goes. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. That's amazing. I mean, that's the most phenomenal opening. You talk about hooking somebody immediately. Y'all are looking at me like I'm a few hairs short of a wig right now. So I know. You wouldn't get it unless you understand the geographic and historical context that certainly grabbed the attention of the man. So I'm going to show you some video footage I shot out of a bus window back in the year 2000. Go ahead and roll that if you would, please. This is at the town of Jericho, and those are the layers of the walls that fell, 21 layers deep. when the Israelites came over. And from there, we traveled up past the Mount of Temptations in the background where Jesus was tempted by Satan. And we began to go into a valley. And there we have this waffle-looking thing. That is where they are excavating King Herod's winter palace because he wanted a palace down by the Dead Sea. The problem is that there's no good water there. So he piped water from Jerusalem, 9 miles up, down through this valley called the Valley of the Shadow of Death. All right? And so this old road that goes through that valley is following the aqueduct. You're going to literally see the aqueduct that King Herod built over 2,000 years ago, and guess what? It still works. He was an amazing builder. But we are now in the Valley of the Shadow of Death. This road is so dangerous that they now have closed it down. So I will not be able to take my tour group in there in 2 weeks when we go. But this is the Valley of the Shadow of Death, and we're in this old bus. There's about 30 of us. You'll hear my wife, you'll hear me, you'll hear a lot of people as I let the audio come up here in just a second, because I want you to feel like you're on the bus ride with us. I'm out the window with this little handheld camera, and here we go. I'm going to let the audio come.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my Lord.
I'm not believing this. On the Jericho Road. Oh,
my goodness. I have no power. Amazing, lovely. Now be ready for the left turn. You can close your eyes as Alex does if it gets a little too taking it to the right of the open. Oh, hey, Yofi Sharaga. You want to stop here for a picture?
No, let's go.
Okay, that's all I ever got.
Let's go. They've got a truck behind you.
Shall I miss you?
No, let's not do that. Let's not pull over.
I'm praying.
Oh, my goodness.
This is where the Good Samaritan story took place, somewhere in these mountains.
Good gosh.
A truck just passed us on this ledge, just an inch from going over. Okay? Did you see that? An inch. He was an inch from going over the edge.
Take the audio down, but let the video keep playing. I want you to see this professor and his study group right here. That's the old road. The professor has a white shirt and a white hat right in the middle. If he takes one step backwards, he drops about 2,000 feet. He's a dead man. All right, you can turn it off now. The medieval crusaders said that this was the most dangerous road on the face of the earth, and they would not be caught on it. This was the place that was known where the robbers and the thieves and the murderers lived. And if anyone came along, especially without a protected party, they were dead. It's a given. Do you think Jesus knows how to immediately capture the attention of a man when he says, a man was traveling? How many is that? One. He doesn't have an entourage of protection. He's by himself. Where is he traveling? On that road through the Valley of the Shadow of Death from Jerusalem to Jericho. Oh, whoa, what? The guy's jaw drops open. What's he doing traveling by himself? What a dumb person. You don't go there by yourself. Well, that's the most dangerous road on the face there. He's a dead man. He's dead. He has hooked that man so fast. And now you understand why. See, the King James translators, they didn't know what that road looked like. They had never been there. And that's why later they're going to tell you that he passed by on the other side. No. He didn't pass by on the other side. He stepped over the guy. That's a more accurate translation. So what happens in the story? A man was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers. If teenagers had written the Bible, we would have here, well, duh, of course he did. They stripped him, they beat him up, and they fled, leaving him half dead. These are really mean guys. They didn't go ahead and have mercy and just tip the guy on out into there so he would die quickly. They left him out there to die to the elements after he'd already been beaten up. That's bad. Well, then Jesus puts a priest in the story. This is an Israelite of the highest order, the most spiritual man in the kingdom. A priest happened to be going down that road. Now, what is he doing out there by himself? And he passed by on the other side? Oh, no. And he, say it with me, stepped over the guy. Now, we can't justify in any means whatsoever why he didn't help, but then again, you look at the situation. What are you going to do for the dude? I mean, he's half dead already, which means that the robbers are still there. You stop, you're dead. You sure can't help anybody if you're dead. Maybe at least if I go down to the city, I could send somebody up for him. Of course, by then, he'll be dead. But I mean, it's a real predicament, right? But we're not justifying the fact that he didn't stop to help. We're just painting the situation for what it really was. It's a tough situation to be in, right? Very vulnerable situation. So then Jesus throws a Levite into the picture. And that's the person from the tribe from which the priests come. So he's in line maybe to be a priest. Or maybe he's an ancestor of a priest. What does he do? Same thing. Scared to death for his life. He gets out of Dodge. And now Jesus throws a curveball. It's one of those curveballs that starts at the head of the batter, and the batter's like ducking, and it drops down for a strike on the outside corner. Woo! We call them wicked curveballs. He puts a curveball in the picture. He throws a Samaritan in there. Now, if you go back in the Old Testament, God said to his people, you're to keep my Sabbath laws. And every seventh year, the land is to have its rest. Well, guess what? They did the same thing America's doing. They did away with the idea of having Sunday as a sacred day or whatever day it would be for us. And now it's just become another utilitarian day to make a lot more money. Well, that's what they did. They didn't keep the Sabbath year. They didn't let the land have its rest because it's commerce. It's more money. And so God's like, hey, I told you. And so the Assyrians came in 725 AD and they took away the 10 northern tribes into captivity. And then King Nebuchadnezzar comes in 606 and he sacks about 10% of Jerusalem. Then his son takes it up. And in 597 and 586, Nebuchadrezzar comes in. You thought his name was Nebuchadnezzar. How many of you thought it was Nebuchadnezzar? It's Nebuchadrezzar. Some scribe got real sleepy and let the R go down into an N, and it's stuck in our English translations. But in Hebrew, it's Nebuchadrezzar. Now, you're not going to go to hell if you don't know that, all right? Anyway, so Nebuchadrezzar comes in. He does his thing. By the time Jerusalem is sacked, only 10% of the people are left. What happened to the other people? They got taken into Babylonian captivity. How many years? 70. If you count up how many Sabbath years didn't get kept by the Israelites because they wanted money more than God's law, guess how many years it was? 70. God saw that his land had its rest. He's serious about it. And so here we have this Samaritan who came from the race of people that was taken away, because here's what happened. At the end of that 70 years, Nehemiah and Ezra were commissioned to go back into Jerusalem and rebuild it. And a whole bunch of people went back with them. And the remnant returned, and they did it. But guess what? Some of the Israelites, some of the Jewish people, decided not to go back because they had intermarried with the pagans. They had intermarried with people that were idol worshipers. And they had children with them. And they still believed in God as Yahweh, but they also believed in Dagon and all these others, and they were worshiping them and all that. They kind of mixed their religion all up. And so the purest Jews who went back and rebuilt Jerusalem would have nothing to do with them. And they became a separated race of people known as the, say it with me, Samaritans. They built their own temple in Samaria. And Samaria's in the middle. Up here is that beautiful land of Galilee. Down here is Jerusalem. It's 90 miles apart. And a good Jew would never set foot in Samaria. He would go across the Jordan River, go 50 miles out of his way because he didn't want to get cooties by coming in contact with a stinking Samaritan. Did you know that the Jewish rabbis said a prayer for centuries? Oh Lord, upon his death, may the Samaritan be buried so deeply that he will not be able to get out on the day of judgment. There's never been a hatred more pure than between the Samaritans and the Jews. And so what does Jesus do? Picks a Samaritan after the priest and the Levite. Boy, can he tell a story or what? And the Samaritan comes along, and of course you expect, oh, it's a half-dead Jew. Let me just finish him off. Stinking Jewish people. That's not what he does. Let's look at the Bible. Verse 33. But a Samaritan on his journey came up to him, and when he saw the man, he had, what's the word? Compassion. I bet you've got that circled. Is that a beautiful reaction? He had compassion. He went over to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on olive oil and wine. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and he said, now you take care of him, and when I come back, I'll reimburse you for whatever else you expend. So he gave him his Bank of Jerusalem card. Here, use it. Here's the pen. Now Jesus has finished his story, so you expect at this point he will do what all of us preachers do. We don't think you're really all that smart, evidently, because we'll spend 30 minutes on a sermon and then we'll figure, well, they probably didn't really get it, so we'll summarize it in bullet points that maybe you can at least digest and take those home with you, right? We tell you what to get out of what you just spent 30 minutes here. It's like when people on outdoor television, you know, they spend 10 minutes calling this turkey in, and they finally shoot the turkey, and then they walk up to it, and the rest of the show is they're sitting there in one static shot telling you what they just did. I just saw what you did. Why are you telling me all over again what you just did? You think I'm stupid? And that's how I think we treat you sometimes with our sermons. Like you don't have a brain. Like you can't think for yourself. Jesus doesn't treat you that way. Jesus doesn't give all those bullet points and retell you what he just said. He's laid the story out. Now he's going to ask you, okay, so what do you think here? He's back to his other style of teaching. What is it? Asking questions, because he wants you to think for yourself. He wants you to figure it out and use the brain that God's given you to do so. So he asked a question in verse 36. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? So the guy answers him. Was it the priest? Was it the Levite? Or was it the Samaritan? You people can talk without going to hell here. I promise you, you can talk in church. Which one was it? So the guy didn't say priest. The guy didn't say Levite. What did the guy say? Louder. What? No. No, he did not say that. He couldn't say that. He couldn't bring himself to even let the S hardly come out. The one who helped. Now, Jesus doesn't scold him, but he does give the greatest ending, the greatest application to a sermon ever preached. Is all he says. You say it with me if you know it. He said, go and do likewise. That's it. Boy, I tell you, this story is amazing, isn't it? I think it's probably one of the greatest sermons ever preached. I love the characters. They're very interesting. I think the relevance of the text is very stimulating. I think it is a contemporary story. I think it reaches across continents and centuries and applies to us just as much as it did to that teacher of the law. But what I really, really want us to look at this morning are the challenges that emerge from this text. Here's the first one. We are to overcome prejudice. I don't know of any other way to say it than this. If you're prejudiced, you're sinning. All right? I don't like beating around the bush. And when I go home, you're going to know what I think. And sometimes I'll throw it and let it hit the fan, and then the preacher gets to deal with it after I go home. All right? So if that's what happens, that's what happens. But I'm going to tell you what the Bible says. If you're prejudiced, you're in sin. Because you are not supposed to be prejudiced. Prejudice is not a normal thing. It is a learned thing. It is taught to us by our environment. If you are prejudiced, you need to repent. And you need to ask God to change you. Secondly, we are to cross over social and religious boundaries to serve people. So we're to go across the tracks and serve those who are much less fortunate. But you got to also remember there's another set of tracks on the other side of town. We're to cross over tracks to serve those who are a whole lot more rich than we are. We can't have this standard for one but not the other. Now, let's talk about this religious thing for a second. What that means is that you got to reach out and serve those folks over there in the Church of Christ, even though they think they're the only ones going. And you've also got to serve those Catholic folks, even though you don't really agree with their theology. And you've also got to serve the Pentecostals, and you've got to serve all those other folks, and you've also got to serve the Hindus, and believe it or not, even the Mormons. But I ain't going to serve no Muslim. Okay, who gives you the right to draw that line? Show me in Scripture where you have the right to draw that line. Because you don't have that right. This story says that you serve people no matter what their religious convictions are. You don't draw any lines when it comes to serving someone in need. Here's the third one. We're to sacrifice our time, our comfort, and even our possessions to serve people who hate our guts. It's getting tougher, isn't it? I'm not done yet. Wow. Okay, so you know, it's one thing to go mow the yard of the widow and get a pie and a hug. It's another thing to serve your ex. I've had people get up and walk out when I say that. Do we have any junior high girls in here? Raise your hand if you're a junior high girl. Anybody? Okay, would you please stand? Just for a second. Anybody else over here, junior high girls? So we have one in here. All right, you're a brave soul. Two. Okay, awesome. What's your name? Leah and? Braislin. Okay, Leah and Braislin. Let me just explain something about junior high girls. Best way I know how to explain it is this. I've had to kill a bear in self-defense. That was scary. I was in the Amazon jungle and thought I was going to die to head-shrinking cannibals. That was even more scary. But there's nothing that puts more fear in my heart than a junior high girl. All right? They can be the most vicious, knife-wielding, I'm going to cut your heart out, take a bite out of it, and show it to you before you die people that ever walked on the face of the earth. Okay? Now, I'm not talking about you two beautiful young ladies. Okay? I'm talking about all the ones that are doing that to you at school. Okay? Because they are. I guarantee you, I know they are. And there's some girls that would like to see you dead. There's some girls that would try to ruin your reputation. They will backstab you so fast. And so what Jesus is saying in this story to both of you girls is this. In spite of how they treat you, and in spite of what they say, and in spite of what they do, you're to serve them and love them. Hardest thing you will ever do. But you know what? You got a good, godly family around you to support you and encourage you. You got God on your side and the Holy Spirit living in you. You can do it, right? Because you've got marching orders to do it. So let's give them a hand. They're going to do it. All right? Y'all can sit down. See, that's what he's saying here. That's what we're facing. Here's the fourth one. You're not going to like this one. I'm probably never going to get invited back here, I know, after this lesson. But I just have to say, I'm only an ambassador. I'm just a reporter. This is Jesus stuff, not mine. We're to allow ourselves to become, vulnerable. Aren't we all about safety? Now you be safe. Now you lock your doors. Now don't you put yourself in any situation of harm. I mean, how many of you have ever said that to not only yourself, but especially your family, right? Oh, it sure is a different thing when you tell your kids, I don't want you to be safe. I want you to become vulnerable. I want you to put yourself in a situation where you actually may be killed. We don't need more doctors in America. We need doctors over in Bangladesh. We don't need any more people making millions over in America. We need some ministers, some missionaries over there in India or in Africa. And I know they're killing lots of people over there and in Iraq and in Pakistan. If you're a Christian, man, you get blown up. But you know what? We need you to go there, son, granddaughter. That's what this story says. We're to allow ourselves to become vulnerable and place ourselves at risk to serve others. C.S. Lewis said it best. He said, if you're looking for a religion that's comfortable, I certainly don't recommend Christianity. And yet, in America, we've turned it into a social club thing. That's what it is. And you know how we handle preachers that rock the boat? Fire them. Every 2.8 years on average. Because we don't like to be uncomfortable, do we? Here's the last one. We're to accept the challenge and the responsibility to go and do likewise. In our travels, we've circled the world a couple of times, and it's either filming or it's on mission trips, and we try to make a point to get out of the vacation spots if we're in a vacation spot. We try to get out 30 minutes. That's about all it usually takes. And you start running into the extreme poverty, how most of the world really lives. And what we have seen are people who are knocked down and drug around and left for half dead. And so many times, they're children. They're living the most destitute lives. They have nothing. They weren't robbed of anything because they never had anything in the beginning to be robbed of. But it's one of the most tragic things I've ever seen are all these thousands and thousands and thousands, really hundreds of thousands and millions of children that have zero. They have no hope. They have nothing. Some of them don't even have a family. It is so incredibly sad. I did some statistics just wanting to kind of find out more about this. Did you know that about 20,000 children will die today while we are at church and eating lunch and eating supper tonight? You want to know why they'll die? Because they will not have the right nutrition. They will not have the right drinking water and the right shelter. 20,000. Did you know that tomorrow, when these two junior high girls go to school, or soon, there will be 100 million school-aged children who will not have the opportunity to go to school. And 200 million of them can't write their own name. Now, that's the condition of the world. If we took every child in the world, including all the ones in this room, and we lined them all up, we would ask one out of every five to step forward. That's how many kids will go to bed tonight not having put one bite of food in their mouth. Now, here's what happens with us in America. We live in a bubble, and we allow our bubble that we live in to set our perception of how everyone else lives. And we think that the rest of the people in the world live the same way we do here in South Georgia or back in Nashville. Nothing could be further from the truth. And what we need are some good Samaritans who will come along and do as the good Samaritan in the story did. I had someone come to me and say, you know, Jimmy, all these people that y'all film with, there's quite a number of them that really have super deep bank accounts. Some of them have Learjets and multiple homes and all of this. What if you could figure out a way to get an audience with about, let's say, the top 10% of the world's wealthiest people, and you could share this message with them? Do you think it would really, truly make a difference? And I'm thinking, yeah, it really would. So I tried to figure out who are, what is the category of people that live in the top 10% of the world's wealthiest people? And I came across a test that sociologists put together, and it has five questions. We're going to take it. Raise your hand if you can answer yes. Do you have a telephone? Question two, do you have a television? Question three, do you have a means of transportation to go wherever you need to go, whenever you need to go there? Question four, do you have the ability to walk into a closet and you have a choice of clean clothes? And we have junior high kids here, so we'll take out the adjective clean. You have a choice of clothes that you can wear that day. Can you do that? Now, there's a closet in your kitchen. It's called a pantry, and also a refrigerator. It's a cold pantry. Do you have the opportunity every day to go into your kitchen and you have a choice of one good, nutritious meal? Can you do that every day? Okay. If you answered four out of five of those with a yes, you are in the top 10% of the world's wealthiest people. There's your paradigm shift. I used to think it was the people with the Learjets that were the rich, that were going to find it very tough to go through to heaven. Remember the eye of the needle story? I used to think of those folks. I used to think of the Hollywood stars you see on TV and the big singers making millions as the rich. Now I have to consider myself as the wealthy. And probably that's the case for everyone in this room. We are the world's wealthiest people. How we live with our wealth will determine our relationship with God. You think that that's not in the Bible? Listen to Jeremiah chapter 22, 15 and 16, and notice it is God speaking. And God says this, "Did your father not have food and drink, and he did what was right and just, so all went well with him? He defended the cause of the whom? Poor and needy, so all went well." Look at the last line. "Is that not what it means to know me, declares the Lord?" Are you starting to see Scripture coming alive here this morning? It's our responsibility to go and do likewise. It's what the church is all about. It's what we Christians are all about. And I would especially say that's the case when it comes to children. They're the most desperate of all. And that's why I am so incredibly thankful for the various ministries that specifically help children. The one that my family and I have primarily hung our hat on is called Compassion International. Has anybody ever heard of Compassion International here in the room? If you've ever gone to a Christian concert, they usually will stop in the intermission and they'll show a video and talk about it. There was a Baptist pastor. There's a movie coming out, by the way. There's a Baptist pastor named Elmer Swanson after World War II who was in one of the Asian countries, and he had all these war orphans, and he started taking care of them, and he ran out of money, so he wrote letters back to his friends in the United States and said, "I got all these kids, I need help," and they started sending money. That was the beginning of it. And it got to the point over the years that over 300 of those children graduated from the program and became ministers in that country and started churches. And those churches took over, and Elmer Swanson announced to all of his friends, "You don't need to send any more money. We're good here now." And it started to grow, and we're now in 26 countries. We've graduated 1 million kids out of the program, and not one of their children has had to be enrolled in it. We currently have 1.5 million children enrolled. We help them go to school. We help them. We partner with churches, and the churches have a place where these kids come and learn the Bible. They get medical care. They get a good meal every day. And so what we're really doing is helping them break the poverty cycle and learn about Jesus. And we have our first child now who's the president of an African country. That's the work of Compassion. I don't want to sound like an infomercial. I'm just telling you, there are some ministries out there that are so good at what they do, and they have ethics. I know that over all these 65 years, they've never gone under 80 cents spent on the child and 20 cents on administration. They will never, ever go below that on any donation. And I love that about them. But I've got a video I want to show you from these kids. It's so much better if you get to just see them. So let's take a look at this.
We are all the children of the world.
We are your children, whether you know us or not.
Most of us are poor.
All of us are vulnerable.
To disease.
And family violence.
And weather.
And war.
We're not coming.
We're here, right in front of you.
2 billion of us under the age of 16.
We're tomorrow's parents.
Tomorrow's leaders.
Tomorrow's builders.
Soldiers, teachers. We'll grow up to accept things as they are.
Or change things.
For better or worse. What difference do you think it would make if 2 billion children grew up with hope?
And not despair.
Teach us.
Train us.
Protect and heal us.
Inspire us.
Show us how to lead.
And serve. Give us skills for living.
Let us know we matter.
Help us.
And we'll help our communities.
When we learn to use water safely,
we'll show our families how it's done.
When we learn to read,
we'll teach our parents.
Help us meet Jesus.
And we'll introduce him to our families and friends. Give us a reason to hope.
And we'll pass it on.
Help us grow up whole and healthy and make a difference.
And make a difference.
Make a difference.
Because whether you know us or not,
we're all the children of the world.
We
We may not be your flesh and blood,
but we're still your children.
Every one of us.
Every one of us.
Every one of us.
Every one of us. And what difference do you think it would make
if 2 billion children grew up with hope
and not despair?
Children are beautiful, and this ministry is beautiful. And for 33 years, I've been a spokesperson for them. And I think somewhere around 2,000 children have been sponsored through the speaking engagements. And for every child that is sponsored, the average sponsor stays 8 years. That child graduates from high school with the ability to get a job. They get a good job, and they can help their family be supported up to 9 members, and they break the poverty cycle. So this generational curse of poverty can be broken. It's like funding a silent revolution in a lot of these dictator countries because we're educating their country. And it's just pretty amazing to see what happens. On some of the trips, that's my wife, down in Mexico, we would take in gifts to them so that if they would see the dentist, then they would get to go back to the previous slide, please. I'll tell you when to change. There you go. We would take a gift in, and if they would see the dentist and or whatever we had with us, you know, then they would get a gift. And these are just some of the kids that we got to meet. And on the next little slide, there's a little fellow named Alejandro. Go ahead and change that. And he lived in the Mexico City garbage dump with about 40 million other people. He lived in a cardboard house, so they would find cardboard to make their walls, old rafter, two-by-fours, and they would take bottle caps, drive their nails through the bottle caps to hold the cardboard on, tin roof, dirt floor, and there were 3 generations living in that house. And this little fella... his name was Alexander, I'm sorry, Jesus. His name was Jesus. And he had leukemia, so Compassion took him in 2 days a week for treatment. He's now a worship leader in Mexico in his 20s. How about that? He had a dog named Guapo. He said, "This is my dog Guapo," which means handsome. It's the ugliest dog I've ever seen in my life. Go to the next slide. This little girl here is named Ruth, and she was born without an arm. And she was one of the teenagers that just thrived at the Compassion Project and was taking care of all the little ones. If she had been left on the streets, she would have been so abused. Next picture is a little girl named Alejandra. And she was 2.5 when she was brought to the project, and she had been so abused, she couldn't talk for about 2 years. But over the years going down, we watched her blossom until by the time, next picture, she was a teenager on the right-hand side. She was the vibrant light bulb in that project of 89 kids. Go to the next slide. One day I was asking these kids their names. You know, "Como te llamo?" What is your name? And "Yo me llamo Jaime Cites," but my name is Jimmy Sice. And "Mucho gusto," good to meet you, and all that. And I was saying, "You know, ¿cuántos años? How old are you?" Well, there's this little girl that was in the back, and I was like, "Como te llamo? What is your name?" Leona. I said, "What? Leona." And I couldn't get her to look up at me. And about that time, these 2 little boys behind her go, "Iguana. Her name's Iguana," and they laughed. They were calling her Lizard Face. Well, she raised her face up and kind of looked at them, and then I could see that one half of her face was disfigured. It was lower, and that eye was discolored, didn't work. Her mouth didn't work. She was never going to win any beauty contest. That made me so mad. I don't know that I've ever been so mad in my life. And I took those 2 little boys, kind of like behind the woodshed, so to speak, and I got down on my knees and I looked them in the eye. And back then, my hair was brown. And I was about 50 at the time. So I was the exact same age that Chuck Norris was when he played Walker, Texas Ranger. And everywhere I went in the world, people thought I was Chuck Norris. Literally everywhere. I had to sign at least 1,000 autographs for Chuck Norris to get people rid of me. So I'd always put Chump Norris. And so if you ever see a Chump Norris autograph, you know where it came from. Well, I told those little boys, I said, "I am really Chuck Norris." And they were... And I said, "If you ever call her Lizard Face again, I know which bunk you sleep in, and I will hunt you down." "Si, senor. Si, senor. Si, senor." And I mean, I left those little fellas shaking, and I went back. Right or wrong, I did it. And so I got on my knee, and I found Juliana. That was her name. And I lifted her chin up, and I'm looking in her good eye, and I said, "Juliana, tú eres muy bonita. You're very beautiful." And I gave her a little bit of a hug. And I said, "Jesus, te ama. Jesus loves you. Dios te ama. God loves you. Jaime te ama. Jimmy loves you. Tu eres muy bonita." And she hugged me with that little pencil arm so hard that she almost cramped my neck. Well, 3 days go by. It's time for me and my family to go home. We'd gone down there for spring break. And we knew the game. We took an extra suitcase because we knew what was about to happen. And so we had the suitcase right behind us. It's empty. All the kids line up. And they come by and they cry and they hug everybody and they give you a little gift that they've made. You know, it might be a bottle cap, you know, with the thumbprint on it. That's what Juliana had. And they come through, so we're like, we cry, and we take them, we hug them. You know, by the time you get to about kid 50, you're cried completely out. I mean, you don't have a tear left. You really feel bad, so you can learn to fake cry. Oh, I'm going to miss you so much. You don't know that. And so finally, you come to the last kid. And I look down there, and guess who it is? It's Juliana. Now, I only have one picture of Juliana. This was in a newspaper article. You can see my daughter there in the middle, but I've circled her. She's hiding her face. She avoided cameras at all cost. And here she comes, last in line. Of course she's last in line. She's the most insignificant person at that place in her own mind. She's a lizard face. And as she stepped up to me, she gave me this little, it was like a Gatorade bottle cap back when they were bigger in tin, and she had painted it green, and she had thumb painted yellow, and she gave her my thumbprint and said, "I love you" on it. And she handed it to me. And I took it and I placed it in the suitcase and I gave her a big hug and kind of picked her up. And she put both arms around my neck and she whispered in my ear, "Will you ever come back?" And I don't know where they came from, but tears just projected, not down my cheeks, off my cheeks. Because it just filled my heart with the understanding that this little girl may have never, ever been told in her life that she was beautiful, that she was worthy, that she was a human, not a lizard. And she hoped that she would be told that again and be in the presence of somebody who cared for her. I want to tell you, folks, there are Julianas all over the world, little boys and little girls, and they don't have squat. They don't have anything. They have no future. They have no hope whatsoever. And for me and my family, we have learned over 33 years that we can reach out and make a difference through this ministry of compassion. If you want to be involved in it, I would love for you to be. Come see me. I've got some kids on the table. But let me say this. Do not take one penny from your tithe to this church. All of us have the obligation, scripturally, to tithe to our church. All right? And you need to be, if you're not tithing, you need to be tithing to this church. Teenagers, if you make $100 a month, 10 of it needs to go to this church. I'm telling you, everybody tithes. It's a kingdom thing. It's a spiritual thing. All right? Don't take from that to do something else. But if there is money is sitting around that you're using for Netflix or for eating out or you get a little extra or whatever it is and you want to use it in a good way and it doesn't hurt the finances of this church, then I've got a way that you can do that. I'd love to share it with you. Just come see me at the table. Lord, we thank you for this story that you have told in Luke 10. We thank you for the way that you tell stories. It's just amazing. We thank you for what you teach us, even though it's super uncomfortable to hear. We know we need to do it. And so now we ask that your Holy Spirit will give us, work within us, the power to respond to your messages and do these things, Lord, that we're called to do. And I pray, Father, as we're reaching out and serving people, that we can also make a difference for these children in these third world countries that just have no hope. Use us in our wealth to make a difference for them and help them break the poverty cycle and come to know you. In the name of Jesus, amen. Thank you.